Good morning, people. And with a sad heart, I have to say that John Lewis, the civil rights leader and friend of Martin Luther King, who just, you know, he passed away at age 80. John Lewis, civil rights leader, who preached nonviolence while enduring beatings and jailings during the Seminole frontline confrontations of the 1960s, and later spent more than three decades in Congress defending the crucial gains he had helped achieve for people of color, has died at 80 years old. And his death was announced in statements from his family and from the House Speaker Nancy Pelosi and advisors to some senior Democratic leaders confirmed that he died, but other details are not immediately available. And Mr. Lewis, a Georgia Democrat, announced his diagnosis of pancreatic cancer on December 29th and said he planned to continue working amid treatment. I've been in some kind of fight for freedom, equality, basic human rights for nearly my entire life, he said in a statement. Now, I've never faced a fight quite like this one I have now, speaking about the cancer. And we just lost Elijah Cummings, another prominent black man in Congress a few months back. Now we just lost John Lewis. And, you know, it's a sad day, man, you know, because then you got to think about he has lived a full life. 80 years is a full life, and he's dedicated his life to trying to help people and trying to get things done. And when you're trying to go up against systematic racism in a country like the United States, that's not an easy task, but he still took it on anyway. His last public appearance came at the Black Lives Matter Plaza with D.C. Mayor Muriel Bowser on Sunday morning in June, 2 days after taping a virtual town hall online with former President Barack Obama. And while Lewis was not a policy maven as a lawmaker, he served the role of the conscience of the Democratic caucus on many matters. His reputation as keeper of the 1960s flame defined his career in Congress. When George Bush vetoed a bill easing requirements to bring employment discrimination suits in 1990, Mr. Lewis rallied support for his revival. It became law as the Civil Rights Act of 1991. It took a dozen years. But in 2003, he won authorization for construction of the National Museum of African American History and Culture on the D.C. Mall. 2012, when Representative Paul Brown proposed eliminating funding for one aspect of the voting rights, Mr. Lewis denounced the move as shameful and the amendment died. Mr. Lewis' final years in the House were marked by a personal conflict with Trump. Russia's interference in the 2016 election, Mr. Lewis said, rendered Trump's victory illegitimate. He boycotted Trump's inauguration. Later, during the House's formal debate on whether to proceed with the impeachment process, Mr. Lewis had evinced no doubts. For some, this vote might be hard, he said on the House floor on December 19, 2019, but we have a mandate and a mission to be on the right side of history. Born to impoverished sharecroppers, Mr. Lewis was a high school student in 1955. We heard about the broadcast by Reverend Martin Luther King that drew him into activism. Every minister I'd ever heard talk about over yonder, where we'd be on, put on white robes and golden slippers and sit with angels, he recalled in a 1998 memoir, Walking with the Wind. But this man was talking about dealing with the problems people were facing in their lives right now, specifically blacks that lived in the South. Mr. Lewis vaulted from obscurity in 1963 to head the Student Nonviolent Coordination Committee, which he helped form 3 years later. Now SNCC had become a kind of advance guard of the movement, helping organize sit-ins and demonstrations throughout the South. When within weeks of taking over, SNCC, Mr. Lewis was in the Oval Office with five nationally known black leaders, including King, Whitney Young, A. Philip Randolph, James Farmer, and Roy Wilkins. Labeled the Big Six by the press, they rejected President John F. Kennedy's request to cancel the March on Washington, planned for that August. They promised to lure hundreds of thousands of protesters to the doorstep of the White House to push for strong civil rights legislation. The presidents argued that the march would inflame tensions with powerful Southern politicians and set back the cause for civil rights. From the steps of the Lincoln Memorial, King delivered his aspirational I Have a Dream speech, which Mr. Lewis, at 23, the youngest speaker, gave a prescient warning. If we do not get meaningful legislation out of this Congress, the time will come when we will not confine our marching to Washington. We must say, wake up, America, wake up. But we cannot stop, and we will not be patient. The toughest of the major addresses Mr. Lewis' text had, in fact, been toned down earlier that day at the behest of his seniors, including King, his mentor. They feared that explicit condemnation of the Kennedy administration's timidity and the threat of a scorched earth approach would create a political backlash. The contrast with his elders symbolized Mr. Lewis's unusual role in those tumultuous years. At critical moments, he rebuffed their advance to give legislation or litigation more time. Handcuffs and truncheons never dulled his belief in confrontation. Yet, he stoutly opposed the militant black nationalists such as Stokely Carmichael, who would later take over the SNCC. As the last survivor of the Big Six, Mr. Lewis was one who kept striving for unity. Time magazine included him in a 1975 list of living saints, headed by Mother Teresa, with only Mao, Hyperbol, and the New Republic in 1996 called him the last integrationalist. And Taylor Branch, a Pulitzer Prize winning historian of civil rights movement who had known Mr. Lewis since the 60s, said in an interview, his most distinguishing mark was his steadfastness. He showed lifelong fidelity to the idea of one man, one vote, democracy as the defining purpose of the United States. John Lewis saw racism as a stubborn gate in freedom's way, but if you take seriously the democratic purpose, whites as well as blacks benefit, Branch said, and he became a rather lonely guardian of nonviolence. On Inauguration Day in 2009, Obama, the country's first black president, gave Mr. Lewis a photo with the inscription, "Because of you, John." It joined a memorabilia collection that included the pen President Lyndon Johnson handed him after signing the Voting Rights Act of 1965. Yep. Telling you, boy. So going back to Bloody Sunday, which provided inside for the 15th Amendment 95 years later after its enactment, which was the voters' rights, is Lewis's saga's richest chapter, what he called a highlight of my involvement in the movement. The 1964 Civil Rights Act was beneficial in terms of public accommodations and employment, but its voting provision was ineffective. Civil rights workers were attacked frequently, occasionally fatally torching and dynamiting, with black churches were rising. Perpetrators that often known, went unpunished. Local registrars continued to bar blacks. Only if black citizens could vote in large numbers, civil rights leaders believed, would the Deep South officials enforce laws. But Johnson told King in 1964 that Congress dominated by the old Southern lawmakers would reject new legislation. So both the SNCC and King Southern Christian Leadership Conference decided to step up organizing in Selma, Alabama. Black residents there constituted half the population, but only 1% could vote. Weeks of demonstration produced only confrontations with police, during one set to an officer shot an unarmed black local resident. In the aftermath, the SCLC staffer proposed a large protest march. from Selma to the state capital, Montgomery. King was in Atlanta, where his senior advisors persuaded him to stay. The SNCC Executive Committee, increasingly resentful of the SCLC's dominance, voted to avoid the event, but SNCC Chairman Lewis would not allow himself to abstain. That decision, he said later, would change the course of my life. In March 7, 1965, became known as Bloody Sunday, with the SCLC's Jose Williams, Mr. Lewis led 600 people to the Edmund Pettus Bridge on Selma's outskirts. There, the police and mounted posse men, deputized civilians, blocked them. Ordered to disperse, the procession held its ground. The troopers charged. Network cameras filming police in gas masks, brutalizing unarmed men, women, and children, many dressed for church. Millions that night saw police using clubs and tear gas, chasing terrified civilians. Mr. Lewis, his skull fractured, went to the hospital along with 77 others. I remember how vivid the sounds were as the troopers rushed toward us, he wrote in his memoir. The clunk of the troopers' heavy boots, the whoops of rebel yells from the white onlookers, clip-clop of horses' hooves hitting the hard asphalt, and the voice of a woman shouting, "Get him!" But Bloody Sunday pricked the national psyche deeply. When King called for reinforcements of a second march to take place on March 9th, which he would lead, hundreds of volunteers, white, black, hurried to Selma. A white minister was beaten and killed by segregationists. Meanwhile, Johnson had an epiphany. Widespread revulsions were so keen that strong voting rights legislation would be politically feasible after all. The president announced the details to the joint session of Congress on March 15th, equating Selma's significance with that of Lexington, Concord, and Appomattox. When Johnson signed the bill, August 6th, Mr. Lewis viewed it as an end to a very long road, but it was also the beginning of a process that extended the franchise to Southern blacks, including Mr. Lewis's mother, who had opposed her son's activism. And so I'm telling you, man, he was involved. He was involved, so he had a long life, and he lived his life as a, you know, as a serious person, getting involved and doing things, you know, the way he thought they should be done. And in the process, he was given, and in 2010, President Obama awarded Mr. Lewis the Presidential Medal of Freedom, the country's highest civilian honor. He continued to say that his conscience demanded that he teach young people the legacy of civil rights movement. In 2013, he began a trilogy of comic book form called March, when a former supporter of the Klan named Elwin Wilson popped out of history in 2009, asking forgiveness for having severely beaten then freedom rider Lewis in 1961 at a Greyhound bus station in South Carolina. Mr. Lewis took him on three TV shows to show that love is stronger than hate. And he revisited the Edmund Pettus Bridge on the anniversary of Bloody Sunday, often accompanied by political leaders of both parties. Barack Obama, he mused, is what comes at the end of that bridge in Selma. So rest in paradise, Brother John Lewis. Rest in paradise. Peace.